All right. Well, welcome back. This is still developing SharePoint Server Solutions. That's still Tom Riesing. I'm still Christopher Harrison. And we got, well, talking, maybe socializing a little bit during the break. And we decided it's time to turn our attention to the social workload capabilities.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So what do you say we have at it?
Yes. All right. So we've got two modules talking about social. We're going to start talking about the user profile data, which is, you know, people are really at the heart of any social solution. I'm going to break this down into three groups of user profile speech, right? We're going to talk about user profiles, just basically generally what they are and how we interact with them. And we're going to talk about how to add people search functionality to an app.
Mm-hmm.
And we are going to display the user profile properties through code.
Perfect.
So let's start with user profiles in SharePoint 2013.
Okay.
All has to do mainly with the user profile service. This is the heart of the user profile data we have available to us in SharePoint 2013. It's been around for a little while.
Yep.
There's a lot of IT pros that have a lot of heartache about this. It's not always the easiest thing to set up. However, it provides a lot of value.
It does provide a lot of value. But one thing that's worth highlighting, because you mentioned the heartache, and there's certainly a lot of heartache in trying to set this up, that getting that user profile service to start for the first time, that sync service, much wailing and gnashing of teeth. One very cool thing is that if you are pulling in from Active Directory, you can actually now do that just straight out of the box, that you don't even need to start the user profile sync service. Now, you're not going to get all the full capabilities that the user profile sync service brings to the table, but if all you're looking for, especially if you're looking for just a dev setup, and I would even say certain organizations where maybe you don't need the capability to start sending a lot of data back into Active Directory, that Active Directory sync is a very nice option that's available to you. So you can actually do these user profiles and get data synced without necessarily setting up the user profile sync service. You're only going to be able to do Active Directory. You're only going to be able to do import. But if that's all that you need, this can be a very easy way to go in and set that up.
Well, thanks for pointing that out, Christopher. I think that's a great it's a great thing to point out. You've got, as a developer, you've got a couple options here, right? I mean, if you're going to be developing directly on a SharePoint server, as the classical model would have it, with full trust solutions, you don't really have much choice other than to set up this user profile service if you really want to dig deep into the social aspect of things. And because of the new Active Directory import, it does make your job as a developer setting up your environment a lot easier. Now, on the other hand, if you are able to move to the cloud app model and SharePoint Online, you can just pass off all that heartache to the brilliant admins and the Microsoft data centers and let them worry about keeping the user profile service running. And that is exactly what I'm going to do today.
Excellent.
Because I'm what I like to call a lazy programmer.
That seems to be a trend in here.
Absolutely, yep. Right? You want to write as little code as possible, right?
Yep.
And you want to leverage as many other resources as possible. In this cloud-connected world, there's so many service applications we can connect to. We talked about it with the external data systems and how we can leverage OData data sources and SQL Server in here. I can leverage the very smart people at the Microsoft data centers and let them worry about all that stuff that I have, I'll tell you, honestly spent weeks wrestling with in previous versions before SharePoint Online. But I still want to talk about the user profile service, even if you hopefully never have to look at it directly. I want you to know what it is because it's powering the people, the user profile data that you have available to you as a developer and as an end user. And if you are working in an organization that doesn't have this available right now, you should be aware that you can add the user profile service to your SharePoint farm to add this this personal touch to your SharePoint implementation. Now, I want to show you something in central administration. Again, I'm going to go to SharePoint Online, and I'm just going to, I don't have to go to my server for this. I'm just going to do it straight from the browser. But let me take you to my SharePoint Admin Center on my Office 365 tenant.
Okay.
So again, like the last module, you can see that the address at the top is at SharePoint.com. That's where all the SharePoint Online services are. But this time, I have a subdomain of tomreising.sharepoint.com is -admin. That's how I get to my admin center in
Yep.
SharePoint Online. You can see a list there of all my site collections, including /site/dev, which is my development center where I deploy apps to. I've also got a public website available there, you can see, and then my private team sites, and my search center, and my My site.
Okay.
On the left-hand side, you see the configuration options I have available to you. You can see BCS. I could see the OData data source I inserted in the last module. And we can go down here to the user profile service and administer it. Now, in this case, I'm not administering it on the level I would if I were on-premises managing everything, right?
Right.
What I see here is I don't go to the service applications like we do in central admin on a local server. I only see the user profile service kind of sub-page, right? This is
Yep.
something we would drill down to and we get to eventually in central admin and an on-premises install. But once we get to this page, it actually looks very similar to what you're used to seeing in central admin on-premises. And you can see up here at the top, there's quite a lot of options for dealing with people in the user profile service, as you'd expect. And also, this is the place where you set up My Sites, which are a big part of the social story in SharePoint. I just want to show you real briefly, we talked about search properties in the search module. Similarly, we have user properties. And as an administrator of a SharePoint Online site, you do have some capability to work with user profiles properties. And even as a developer, you can modify these programmatically as well. But here's what the user interface looks like for all of the default user profile properties that are set up in SharePoint Online. You can see that some of them are normal properties you'd expect to be exposed in the people search or on a My site, like the first name and the last name. And some of them are more like system properties, like the account name and the first time, first run experience integer, right? So those aren't necessarily, those are things that you can take advantage of as a developer. You can create properties that aren't exposed to an end user so much as they allow you to customize and personalize the SharePoint experience to the individuals.
Okay.
You can also see here that there's a group, the groupings of properties, also called subtypes here, and you can filter on subtypes, you can create new subtypes. Those are also things that you can access programmatically. If I go to manage user profiles, I can see there's no wildcard here, I don't think, right? So you can't see everything unless you actually hit a hit a user, right? So my user that I log on with here, this Tom Reising account, you can see the email address property of my user profile, my preferred name, and my account name. Again, this is using claims authentication, so we've got these identifier separated by pipes before my account name to identify me against a claims profile.
Coming back around here, more slides.
Yes, more slides.
There we go. More slides.
So that was just a brief demo of the user interface for accessing the user profile service and getting a look at some of the user profile properties. Now, we'll talk about some of the development options for managing user profile data.
Okay.
So on the server-side object model, the full trust object model as you would have it, you've got full read-write access to user profile data.
Yep.
On the client side, .NET, REST, or JavaScript, you have read-only access to the user profile data.
Right.
Now, this is very helpful to have read access to the user profile data, and it can enrich your apps. And in on top of the read-only access to the user profile data, you also have the ability to set the profile picture.
Yep. Yeah, and you know, the nice part about this, because you might be looking at this and you might be going, well, how come we don't have write access? And, you know, I could definitely understand, you know, why you might be a bit concerned about that limitation. But when you stop and think about the apps that you're going to be building and what it is that you're going to be doing, you know, there's already an interface for going in and modifying somebody's user profile. They just go to their My site and go do that. The real demand here is going to be to read all of that. And so that's why the focus was spent on making sure that you had full read access to everything that's inside of user profiles. That somebody did ask, you know, hey, is it possible to go in and read everything with REST, with JavaScript, CSOM? And the answer is yes, that you can go read whatever data it is that that you might want from any user profile.
Yeah, and that's a good point, really, because in years of experience working with user profile data has shown me that the majority of organizations, the way that they are populating the user profile data is one of two ways.
Yep.
Either they're pulling it in from a directory service like Active Directory or supplementing it with the BCS, as we talked about, from their human resources systems, or they're leaning on the end user to populate data. Right now, maybe Active Directory may be the place where you initially populate, say, like a profile picture, but this is one of the reasons that one is accessible, because that's one that you often want to be able to change.
Yep.
And similarly, users will often type in information about their skills and expertise that may not be held, or their About Me section that might not be held in any active any directory system, but that's a user interaction, right? And once they've populated that, you have access to it through the client-side object model. Now, if you want to see all the users on your site, you have a couple different options. You can use search as one great way. But if you want to enumerate them, here's a couple options you have. You can go to the All Users object on the root web of your site collection, and you can loop through all that. You can enumerate through the users that way. Or you've got another option here, which is to use the user profile manager in the client-side object model. And you can enumerate them similarly.
And by the way, one thing that's worth highlighting real quickly there, if you just want to kick back a slide, is you'll notice that, yes, you can go in and loop through all the user profiles. One of the problems, of course, with any normal-sized organization is you're going to have hundreds, potentially thousands of users. So looping through them all is not necessarily a great way to go about doing it. So you'll notice down at the very bottom there that you could actually just go in and utilize the search capabilities that we discussed earlier to go in and find the user that way rather than enumerating through it.
And that's really a great segue to the next section, which is all about people search.
There you go.
Yeah, great. And once again, we're going to be using the client-side object model and an app here to access people search. We've been introduced in previous modules to the keyword query language, so I won't review that in depth, but I do want to point out one difference about the I'm trying to be fancy like Christopher and highlight things, but I don't think I can do it. Let's see if I can. All right.
There you go, highlighter.
This thing right here.
Yay,
right.
GUID.
Yeah. All right. So this GUID here on the screen, this is a globally unique identifier for the people result source, right? So when you're running your query, you want to get people results, you always want to specify that. And you can see that in the code here with the set source ID to the people results result source. And like we talked about in the search module, right, this is a managed property, first name, right? And you can see we are considering passing in a parameter, in this case, of the first name to do a search. And you're right. I mean, there's going to be in many organizations where this is used. There may be hundreds of thousands of users. There's probably going to be quite a lot of Toms, even. And
Christophers, even.
Christophers.
Yeah, depending on your organization. Yeah. Depending on where you are, you know, I mean, we really shouldn't just focus in on, you know, Anglo-Saxon names, you know, so it could be, you know, any popular name, wherever it is that you happen to be.
Right. All right, so let me show you an example of how you do people search. And once again, I'm going to be doing this directly from my desktop because I can. Okay, so this should look familiar to you. I'm in Visual Studio. I've got a default ASPX that was created by the new app project, like I did for the last module. And I've got, you know, the standard elements. I've got the app CSS for the display. I've got the default.espx, and I've got an app.js. And one thing you should also notice whenever you're talking about these types of apps that we're writing is, you know, you're going to need sometimes some special permissions in the app manifest, in the app manifest.xml. So from Visual Studio, you have a great visual modifier here. If I want to choose any of the search options like Christopher talked about in his module, I can add it here. And if I want to add user profiles, I can do the same thing. And just if you want to see what that looks like, what it writes it out to the XML, you can also take a look here and drill down, and you can see that query as user ignore app principle is written out to the SharePoint/search app permission request. So we need some of those when we're doing social apps, and specifically, I'll point out that tenant one a little bit later. So my default .aspx has basically one placeholder here, and I've got two tags. I've got two tags with IDs that I can modify. And in my client-side object model code in my app.js, I once again, as we always do, set the context. We always are going to do that. And specific to JavaScript and the app model, you're always going to want to wait on the document to be ready. This is using jQuery here. And then call your function from there. So in this case, I'm going to... oh, you know what? This is my... it should have the word search in it, I'm guessing. Let's see.
Okay.
Here it is.
There we go.
Sorry.
No, that's okay. Just, yeah, there you go.
All right.
Beautiful.
And anyway, it's got a very similar layout as the last one.
Yep.
I won't have to review that for the next one. But here we are again with our document.ready function. We've got our context, and the function in this case is search by name. And once again, in the default.aspx, I've sourced this sp.search.js, which contains the functions for search.
And one of the things that's worth highlighting real quickly there, if you want to just go back up and leave that there, is, and we've mentioned this a couple of times, that the client-side object model has been greatly expanded. And so when I was going in and doing my demos, I was doing a lot through through C Sharp. You've got all yours in JavaScript. And I really like kind of that compare and contrast there.
We planned that, didn't we?
Yes, absolutely. The one thing that's worth highlighting is just like I needed all those different references to those different DLLs when I was doing the code inside of C Sharp, you'll also notice that you need all the different references to the different JavaScript files as well to make all of that work. So you'll notice that not only do you need that typical SPJS, which you always need if you're going to be doing any level of CSOM in JavaScript, but you also do need that search as well.
That's a great point, Christopher. I'm glad you pointed that out. It's a little bit different, the way you do things in JavaScript than you do it in C Sharp, but yep. there are some similarities there. Yep. And by default, I'll point out that the sp.js and spruntime.js and the jQuery source of the scripts is always added to your default.ispx when you create a new app project in, at least in Visual Studio 2013 is how I'm doing it. And I only added this one sp.search.js.
Right. Yep. Yeah, and somebody called out in the chat that you know we when you go in and build this that you should be using the onload function names to identify the functions that are called when the page is loaded up rather than doing it through jQuery. You know, and that's fair enough. When you know we're going in and building this, it's you know this is what was already there. Hey, let's just go ahead and go from there. That the real focus is not so much on hey, this is how you build an app, but rather hey, this is how you go in and search user profiles. So that's why we've got it built this way.
Sure. I mean, I think that's a common complaint. This is how yep. This is how the wizard generates everything.
Right. Yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
And,
yeah.
And I yep. think a lot of people choose to do that differently, and I think yep. that's great to point that out. So in my search function, I'm doing a lot of the same things. We've already seen this in Christopher's previous modules on search, right? Mm-hmm. Of course, this is the JavaScript way, which is quite a little bit different. But you've got those named, those managed properties, first name, and I'm doing an OR, which yep. Christopher described how you do that in keyword query language. I'm going to do a search for Tom or Reesing.
Yep.
And I pass the client context into my query object. And I set the query text of the query object to first name
yep.
or last name. And then this important difference between what we were doing earlier in search is the source ID.
Right, and that's that GUID. And one of the nice things to keep in mind, because I mean, like you called out, hey, you know, you've got this GUID here. That's going to be the GUID on every single yeah. People search.
Right.
So you don't have to worry about going in and looking it up. So that's really just going to become boilerplate code. So,
absolutely.
Yeah, not necessarily pretty, but it's always going to be the same. So it does help make your life a little bit easier.
I'm just going to start the deployment in the background here so I can show you some things. So I've done my search, and I've returned that funny account name that yep. we saw in the profile properties. And in the background, some things were happening really quickly there. So I want to go back and show you what happened here. So the package was deployed to... The WSP was built mm-hmm. on my local desktop, and then it was uploaded. Now, in this case, I haven't changed anything since the last time I deployed it. So the
Correct.
Visual Studio was actually smart enough. The reason that happened so quickly mm-hmm. is because it didn't actually redeploy. What would happen if I make a change, in some cases, the WSP will be retracted and then imported again. Now, you can actually do some things a little bit differently. So I can come in here, and I can change this right here. And watch what happens. I want you to watch down here on the ready
okay.
part when I hit save.
I'm watching down there.
Communicating with SharePoint. That went by really fast, right?
That did.
I can do that again. Let me just change this to TO, right?
Yep.
And here it goes again. Communicating with SharePoint.
Wow, that's cool. Okay.
So you know what's happening there is the JavaScript file
mm-hmm.
is being saved from Visual Studio, not just to my local desktop, but also directly to the server.
Oh,
so
no kidding.
I did not have to stop debugging and go
right.
through the redeployment process. I can actually go back to my browser
mm-hmm.
and hit refresh, and you can see the app is running once again. And in mm-hmm. this case, it didn't get any results.
Right. Well, because you there's no two and an empty last name.
Yes. So that's the Java. I wanted to show you that real quick. It also, you can make some changes on this side as well. I could change this to initializing the app. And similarly, when I hit the save button, right, communicating with SharePoint, it's saved. Refresh, and it'll be initializing
yep.
the app. All right. So that's a quick demonstration of how you do a people search in an app in JavaScript.
Perfect. come back around, slide, slide. You have to do the slide dance. See, that's what helps.
Oh, I forgot to do the dance.
Yeah, you got to do the slide dance.
Yeah. All right, now I've got it.
Yeah, there we go. See? And it works.
Great. Now we'll move to the displaying user profile properties section, which clearly this Visual Studio solution is like begging to be seen because it already reared its head in the previous section. But let's talk about how you display user profile properties. You've got a couple different options, right? Of course, we've got all the client-side mm-hmm. options, and we've got some server-side options, right? And then updating is always going to happen on the server side, as we discussed, except for the picture property.
Yep.
And one thing I hadn't mentioned before, we'll talk a little bit about creating user profile properties, and we already kind of had a discussion on why we might use the client side, so we hit that bullet already. So how do you create a user profile, right? This is server-side code we're looking at right here. You're going to use those reference assemblies, similar to what we saw in some demos that Christopher's already done in earlier modules.
Just the Microsoft Office Server, only in this case, rather than Taxonomy, going to be using user profiles, since obviously that's what we're going to be working with.
Right. And once again, you're always going to get your context. We've seen that quite a bit. And you're going to make a new user profile manager. And if you want to create a new, in this case, this is the Contoso, the familiar, mm-hmm. ever familiar Contoso domain.
We are required, by the way, anytime we do a recording, to mention Contoso at least once. We do still have to mention Northwind and AdventureWorks at some later point as well.
I think that's the first AdventureWorks spotting. Yeah.
Exactly.
I did say Northwind
demo. Oh, okay. Yes. Yeah, you're right. You did say Northwind. Okay. Yeah, so we just need to bring up something involving AdventureWorks a little bit later. We actually have a checklist back there. We have to go in and check all that off. Otherwise, we're not allowed to leave the building.
And you feel free to keep track at home. You can even mention Reesing or Geek Trainer, as we mentioned, Northwind and Contoso and AdventureWorks, whatever your favorite is.
For those of you scoring at home.
All right, so let's take a look at how you retrieve the user profile properties using client-side code. We looked at creating it on the server side. You want to always make sure that you are passing in an array of properties. So we took a look in the user interface to see what the properties of the user profile were that are available to us in my SharePoint Online instance. And one of them we did see was account name, and one of them is first name. So I can pass those in as part of my payload to the execute query function and receive back those and only those properties back from the user profile service. You got a good one in the...
No. Nope.
Okay.
Sorry.
All right. So once again, we're using the sp.userprofiles, and we're using the people manager object inside there, and we're passing it our context. Yeah, that always does that. I can't use this touch screen. And we see some of our normal client-side code we're used to seeing. One of them, of course, here is where we're loading the get user profile properties. Let's see, maybe I can do this. All right, I'll try again. Here, get user profile properties for. And we passed in this profile properties request, which we built here with our properties array, which we built here with mm-hmm. the account name and first name, right? So we load our payload here, and we execute our query. And in this case, I used an inline function, and I'm storing the account name that's returned from the profile properties. Now, this is funny. I've actually got an error in the slide. I wonder if you can catch it, Christopher.
A pop quiz.
Yeah, I know. It's on the fly. I'll give you a little bit of a hint here. I will circle it.
Okay.
There.
Oh, yes, counting starts with zero. There you go.
Yep. Right.
Yeah, there is a little typo on the slide there. Yeah.
So it's funny. I copied from a lab manual, and it assigned the first one, you know, the first one to the account name, right? It's the first one in the array, but the accounting in JavaScript starts in a zero, so and it actually assigns the first name to the account name variable.
Yes, and you know, I got to tell you, when I take over the world, one of the first things that I'm doing, all accounting starts with zero, okay? Let's just, you know, skip to the end, all accounting starts with zero. Done.
Well, you know, when you're born, right?
Yeah, see?
You're not 1 year old.
No,
right?
Counting starts with zero.
Right.
Yes.
You're not even 1 month old. All right. And similarly, on the server side, you can also access the user profiles. The code looks a little bit different, but I'm not going to go through this in detail. I just wanted to show you that you have that option on the server side as well. And then once again, if you want to update, you're going to be using server-side code. So it's very simple. You can either use the there's a couple common profile properties that are available right off the user profile object, like display name. Or if it's not one of those common entries there, you can access it through the string first name, right?
Yep.
And you can just set the value. If you're going to use, if you're using a common name like display name, you can just set it directly with the equal sign there. If you're accessing a custom profile property, or one of the ones that's not common, or anything actually that you put in the string there in the indexer, you want to use the dot value, assign the value to the dot value before you commit your changes to the user profile object.
Perfect.
There's a note there about allow unsafe updates. I mean, that's just standard.
Yeah, one of those things you'll notice that if you are using a GET request, that it's expecting POST in order to change all that back. Otherwise, you are going to need to just set the little allow unsafe updates to allow that to change.
All right, now let's jump to that, back to Visual Studio.
Doing the little dance. There we go.
And I'll open back up that last one we were actually looking at before. So again,
there we go.
The
we sort of got a sneak preview of it earlier.
Yeah.
Yeah. That always works.
Just wait, I'm debugging. You can't open a new project while you're debugging in here. All right, so here we are. Again, I've got that similar structure we're used to by now, the default.aspx generated by the wizard, the app.js.
Yep.
I have my document.ready at the beginning, right?
There you go.
And
again, you know, we're okay with that for what we're doing here.
Yes, absolutely. All right. And once again, you can see here, in this case, I added another property of about me. You know, temporarily, I'm just going to pull that out just so we can do some code editing on the fly. And I'm going to comment out this
section. Such a cool feature.
Yeah. All right. So let's deploy this. And, you know, another thing I want to point out, too, is that you can do debugging from Visual Studio of JavaScript.
And that's always fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, in this case, you might have seen that the process took a little bit longer.
Mm-hmm.
The WSP was... it was retracted and then redeployed.
Right.
And because of that, when we go directly to the app web, we're this time prompted to trust the app, right? So again, as I pointed out in the last one, I've changed the app manifest to request specific permissions from the user. And anytime the user is going to try to access this app, they're going to be asked this.
Yep, exactly.
So right now, I've just got my basic Hello Tom Reesing information that's pulled back from... I lied about the debugging.
That's all right. Don't sweat it.
You can do it here, though. Right. You can't do it here. I'm not going to do it there. Let me do the cool change trick, though. We're going to add back in the About Me. So you can see there, I've done Hello, Profile Properties, Item 0, Item 1 for first name and last name. And then I'm going to add back in the About Me property and then save it. Communicating with SharePoint, it's written the app.js back to the server. I'm reload it in the browser, and it's going to make the call to the server there. And here we are with my About Me information.
Very cool. Excellent.
All right.
And doing the little SharePoint slide dance, or PowerPoint, power something.
The PowerPoint dance.
PowerPoint, yes.
Yeah. SharePoint, PowerPoint.
PowerPoint, Power Pivot, Power something.
Performance point.
Yes. All right. We're getting punchy. All right. Yeah. Back to slides. References. All right,
good. So that's a basic rundown of accessing user profile data. And I want to give you some references here. Yeah, these slides are available to download. You can work with user profile data. You can access this from MSDN. There's a little bit more there on accessing the server object model. And once again, in SharePoint 2013, Inside Out, there's a whole chapter on the user profile service and the social aspects. And the developer reference is strangely quiet on this topic. But there is one chapter on the newly released Inside SharePoint 2013.
Excellent. Okay.
That addresses this.
Yep. All right. That sounds great. So, you know, what do you say we take 10? We saw a fair amount of ground there on getting in, programming against our social capabilities, user profiles. Now we're going to dig a little bit deeper into social networking and the capabilities there in the next module. But I don't know about you guys, but we need 10 minutes. So we're going to go ahead and take 10. We'll come on back and we'll close all of this out. We'll see you back here in 10.